everybody, and welcome to Talkin' Outdoors. My name is Steve Wildman Wilson. This is Trey Reed, and we serve as your host here on the show each week. We really want to thank you guys for tuning in today. You know, Trey, I've been doing this show for over 20 years now, and I've never done a show about trapping.
Wildman, this will be the last time you'll be able to say that, because this show is all about trapping this week. We're going to go down to southwest Arkansas, see if we can't catch us some fur bears.
Yeah, Wildman, you can hold that one.
Just don't put my finger down.
Don't put your finger down in there.
Trapping is one of mankind's oldest methods of taking wildlife. Long before the advent of firearms, humans used traps to catch animals for food and clothing and to protect crops and livestock. Trapping played a crucial role in the westward expansion of the United States in the 18th and 19th centuries. Trappers and fur traders blazed a trail for early settlers and established trading posts that became the foundation for many American cities. Although trapping plays a much smaller role in 21st century America, it's still alive and well in the natural state.
Last year we had about 4,400 people get trapper's permits here in Arkansas, along with about 100 or so non-residents that came to Arkansas to trap. Compared to the, say, late 1960s and early 1970s, we have actually about as many trappers now as we did then.
Those trappers sold more than 33,000 pelts, valued at almost $663,000 during the 2012-2013 fur-taking season. Fur prices influence the number of trappers and the time they spend in the woods. For instance, trapper numbers increased substantially when fur prices soared in the late 1970s and early 1980s. But most trappers go afield for more basic reasons.
Trappers are mostly out there, you know, for the challenge of going out in the woods and, you know, figuring out, you know, the animals and their habits and figuring out how to catch them. But, you know, they're doing that in part driven by what the value of those animals are and, you know, for the fur market. So, you know, it does influence how much time they spend in the woods, you know, how much effort they put into trapping. It depends on the fur prices. But most of them are going to go out trapping every year, no matter how many, you know, or what the value of the animals are.
Brad Townsend is a prime example. Townsend is an Arkansas Game and Fish Commission biologist who traps in his spare time.
You're not going to get rich by doing this, but it will give you a little extra income, something to play with. You might actually pay for some of your traps. There's just a great satisfaction of walking up on a trap and seeing a bobcat or a coyote or a fox in it.
Like hunting, trapping also helps control animal populations.
Beavers are a major nuisance to a lot of landowners here in Arkansas. They're actually somewhat of a nuisance to the Game and Fish Commission too, and how we manage our wildlife management areas. And trapping helps keep those populations under control, helps keeping them from becoming, you know, overpopulated, which could cause disease and other issues with them. And trapping is one of the methods we use to make sure that that doesn't happen.
Townsend started trapping fur bears to help the turkeys on his hunting property.
That's one reason I got into it, was try to help the resources. We'd started seeing a bunch of turkeys on our place, on our personal property, and I knew they were trying to nest there, and I was just trying to give them a helping hand. Everybody knows that turkeys have been struggling the last few years. Everything's out to get a turkey, it seems like, from egg to being an adult turkey. While they're an egg, you got skunks and raccoons and possums and that kind of stuff after them. And once they're grown, you know, you get the bobcats and the coyotes and the fox they have to worry about too.
Catching each of those species and the other animals popular among trappers and fur buyers requires somewhat different tactics. Townsend showed Wildman the basics during a recent outing in Hempstead County.
Now, you talked about one of the things that a lot of people think about is catching dogs instead of coons, but these are right. Pretty much dog proof.
Right, that's what one of the nicknames these have gotten. It's called a DP, uh-huh. Dog proof traps. There's several different companies that make different variations of these traps, and that's kind of a catch-all name that they use for these, is a DP.
Mm-hmm.
It's supposed to be dog proof traps. We've baited these with cat food. There's a small trigger down on the inside. A coon will be digging around in there, pulling cat food out, and he'll mm-hmm. reach in there and grab a hold of that trigger, and when he does, this lever here will come off, and he'll be caught there. This is actually what's going to hold the coon in there, that middle wire right there.
All right, let's go set him up.
All right, let's go set him. You have to anchor him, and that's the reason I've got this cable on here. Some guys will use tie wire or use a rebar stake, mm-hmm. put down in that, hold them. I use these cables. I'll just loop it around a tree, or in this case, this vine, pretty big and sturdy. And we will just plant that right down in here, and that'll stick out to them. And then we'll take our fish oil and just kind of squirt a line of it right through there.
Hey, not on me.
Oh, sorry about that.
But basically, you leave it up like that, the coon's going to come down this creek bottom. He's going to smell that,
yep.
or see that, or both.
Yep.
You go over there and start digging in there, and it catches.
That's what we hope.
That's pretty simple.
Yeah.
As in real estate, location is the most important consideration in trapping.
Different species, it varies. Coon and stuff like that, they like to work around creeks. This day and time with corn feeders and stuff like that, you can actually catch quite a few coons around corn feeders. Bobcats, coyotes, and fox, they like to hunt old cutovers, pine plantations, things where, that are gonna hold the animals that they're looking for to eat, rabbits, wild turkey, and stuff like that. I look for an area that they're gonna have to walk by my trap if they're traveling a corridor. I look for scat and tracks and different types of sign that the animal's been there before I ever put a trap down too.
We had a camera set up here earlier in the fall and had a picture of a really nice bobcat using this fire lane right here. So we've got good lanes going in three directions here,
uh-huh.
and they'll use those to hunt off of. So this big intersection right here, I think, will be a good spot to set one up.
Setting a leg hold trap for bobcats and coyotes is much different than setting traps for raccoons. After selecting a site, Townsend starts by digging a dirt hole. It mimics a place where a predator digs into the ground to find burrowing animals like moles or mice. The stick behind the hole is called the backing. Its placement will force an animal to approach the hole from the front, where he'll more likely encounter the trap. The next step is bedding the trap, which entails a snug placement in front of the dirt hole.
You want to get a spot just big enough for your trap to go into, because you don't want to have to try to hide a spot this big.
Okay.
Getting your trap in here and getting it set in there solid is really important, because if a coyote or a fox or something comes in here and he steps on the jaw right here,
okay, doesn't get on that pad.
And he moves it.
Uh-huh.
If the thing rocks back and forth, he's gone.
To keep the trap in place, Townsend uses this anchoring system.
It's called an earth anchor. It's basically like a number one chain with an anchor on it. Stick this piece of stainless cold roll in here.
And drive it down in.
We'll drive it down in there. That little point just turned in there sideways and it's not coming up.
Okay.
The trap is set and situated so that it's flush with the ground. By pressing dirt into the void around the jaws, the trap stays securely in place. Townsend uses peat moss to fill the void inside the jaws. Sprinkling the dirt from the hole over the peat helps the area blend in with the surrounding landscape. Some sort of lure, in this case, beaver castor, is placed in the hole to attract an animal through his sense of smell. A turkey feather dangling from a tree plays on the predator's vision and is intended to draw it close enough for the nose to take over.
Arkansas law states that if you use any animal parts at your trap location, you have to be at least 20 feet from it.
So this feather obviously is an animal part, so we've got
right.
to go 20 feet. Then we just tie it up here,
yep.
let it blow in the wind,
yep.
and that might catch their eye.
I've got a swivel on it, and hopefully it's going to sit here and flutter throughout the night. And if he's coming up this fire lane here, he's going to see this fluttering.
Sure.
And that'll draw him right past that trap set right there.
So you're working on their eyesight, their sense
of smell.
It's yep. all fair in this game, isn't it?
Yep.
That's cool.
To catch beavers and otters, trappers use conibear traps, placing them near areas where the animals get into and out of the water.
They'll swim up here, go in, and you're going to want to come back up this bank, because that's where they've been coming up and down at. And hopefully another one will stick their head through that trap.
Following a full afternoon of setting traps, all that's left is to sit back and wait.
There's coyotes running around everywhere up here, so we've got a good chance of seeing one of those in trap too. So.
Is this sort of like hunting? I mean, I know I have trouble going to sleep the night, you know, before opening day of deer season. Do you get excited, like wanting to get up and go run those traps in the morning?
It's pretty exciting, especially when you come up on a bobcat in a trap. It's pretty fulfilling knowing that you just took out a turkey killer.
And you outsmarted the bobcat.
Yeah, and you outsmarted the bobcat.
But I would imagine just that from handling these beavers here, just a couple, that the wire edge wears off pretty quick. It could be a lot of work, couldn't it?
Yeah, it can turn into a full-time job, daylight till dark sometimes. Yeah.
Doesn't pay very well either.
Yeah, no. You wouldn't want to figure out what your hourly wage is when you're fur trapping.
So. All right, so we're going to go home, go to bed, and come back in the morning.
That's right.
All right.
All right.
Hey, we'll check all those traps right after this break. Hey, welcome back, everybody. It's time to go run those traps that we set out yesterday.
You bet, wild man. Let's go see what we caught.
We set out a bunch of traps last night, coon traps, bobcat traps. Mm-hmm. This is the first trap we're going to run this morning.
That's
looks
right.
Like we've had some pretty good luck.
Yeah, looks like it. We've got a creek right here, and we put a couple of coon sets on it.
Mm-hmm.
And we actually got one in it, so let's go.
That's the way
take a look
to, that's the way it's supposed to work, isn't
yeah,
it?
It's supposed to.
Trapping is more widely accepted in a rural state like Arkansas than in many other places, but it isn't always viewed in the most positive light. Some of the negative attitudes about trapping result from misperceptions and memories of antiquated methods.
I think trapping does get a bad rap a lot of times just because there's not a lot of positive publicity on trapping out there. Most of the stuff you see is like the stuff you see on cartoons, and they've got this big, huge trap that's got teeth and it closes up, and everybody thinks that that's still what we use, which it's not. And they think when an animal gets in there, it kills it, or it's gonna break it, mangle its leg, or something like that, which is just not the case.
People have in their mind these pictures of those old bear traps with the big, you know, jaw teeth on them and the like, and those sort of things haven't been legal for decades. We wanna make sure that the animals are captured and, you know, dispatched in a humane manner.
These days, trapping is highly regulated by the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission.
Trappers have to have licenses. There are certain seasons where they can trap the animals. And we regulate the techniques they use to trap them. You know, because we don't want to over-harvest these animals, we do have these pretty strict oversights of what trappers are doing here in the state. And one of the reasons we keep track of the harvest is to make sure that, you know, we don't take too many of them.
It's not like you just go out there and you're scattering traps all on the ground. It's not anything like that. You have to have a hunting license to trap. You have to have a free trapper's permit to trap. And there are quite a few rules and regulations that you have to follow.
There's no guarantee of success, even when the lures draw a desired species near a trap.
It looks like we got close. I set this trap specifically for bobcat, and we have tracks here right up close to the trap. The pan that set the trap off when he stepped on it is about in this area. You can see where he just walked right up close to it but didn't get in.
So he walked all the way around it and just didn't get in.
Are these tracks right here, Tim? There's one right there, I know.
Wow. Yeah.
It looks like he stepped everywhere except on my pan. So.
All right, guys, looks like this trap's been thrown, but we don't have anything in it.
Right. I set this trap for just whatever got in it, coyote or coon or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And looks like something got in it and just drug it away, and he didn't stay in it, so.
Close but no cigar, huh?
Close but no cigar.
While many of the traps came up empty, there were numerous sets to check, and there was no shortage of raccoons. The next stop was a water set, but instead of finding one of the area's nuisance beavers, this conibear trap contained an otter, a type of fur that usually will fetch a much higher price than beaver pelts.
Male.
The next trap had a different kind of fur bearer, but it wasn't exactly what you'd call the most desirable species.
We've been after coyotes and bobcats and coons and what is this?
Looks like we got a polecat in the trap down there.
In other words, a skunk?
We got a skunk.
So what do we do?
Well, try not to get sprayed.
Oh, now how far can they spray?
Well, seeing that we're downwind of him right now, if he was to spray, we'd catch the brunt of it, I think.
Okay, I'm ready to go.
So, yeah, we need to get on the other side of him.
All right, let's do it.
All right.
After beating a hasty retreat from the polecat, a later stop yielded a different kind of cat. Of all the species trapped in Arkansas, bobcats are one of the most in-demand fur bearers because of their elusive nature and the hefty price they typically fetch at fur sales.
Basically, I had a dirt hole set here, blocked it in pretty hard so coyotes wouldn't mess with it because they don't like to, you know, walk up in stuff, and cats and gray fox won't mind going up in it. I had cat urine on the backing, and then I had a skunk smelling type lure, GH2 is the name of it, mm-hmm. down the hole. And he set them on these trails on the edge of these clear cuts, these old clear cuts, young pine plantations. And they travel these looking for turkey and rabbits, and they see that hole, they're gonna investigate it, and when they smell it, they're gonna get in it.
Near the end of each trapping season, annual fur sales connect Arkansas trappers with fur buyers. It's the place where trappers find out just how much money they'll get for all the fur they've been trapping over the fall and winter.
Wow, Trey, you know we caught beavers, coons, bobcats, but now what are we going to do with them?
We're going to find out what we're going to do with them when we head to the Arkansas Trappers Association fur sale right after this break.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. We're talking about trapping today. And, you know, Trey, I'd never been to a fur sale before. It was quite an experience for me.
It was quite an experience, wild man, for me, too. Hey, if you've never been to a fur sale, here's what it's all about.
Now 14 and a half, 15, now 15 and a half. I got 15, now 15 and a half, 30 to get 15 and a half. I got 15 right here, now 15 and a half, now 16.
There are two fur sales in the state of Arkansas every year. You can sell green fur, you can sell finished fur. Green fur is the animals just skint, rolled up and put in the freezer until the fur sale. They'll thaw it out and it'll be just like you took it off the animal. A finished pelt is one that has been skint, fleshed, all the fat and gristle and meat taken off the hide and put on a stretcher and stretched and dried, and that's finished fur.
Last year, average prices at the fur sale ranged from a low of $1 for opossum pelts to nearly $100 for a bobcat fur. Raccoons went for an average of just over $8 per pelt, while red fox commanded more than $36, and otter pelts brought almost $84. But there are no guarantees on fur prices.
Well, fur prices can change on a dime. They change throughout the trapping season. It may be higher, lower earlier in the season. It may be less, later on. Prices this week, they could be totally different next week based on what goes on in the international market. Fur prices here in Arkansas can be impacted by the weather in Europe. It can just change on a dime, and it does.
The annual fur sales also allow the Game and Fish Commission to gain a better understanding of each year's trapping effort and to keep tabs on the harvest.
One of the ways we do that is collect information from the people that buy and sell them. And at fur sales such as this, take advantage of the opportunity to meet and greet the trappers to actually go out and collect samples for various research projects that we're assisting with universities and other state agencies with.
After the pelts leave the fur sale, they usually go on an international journey.
Well, the pelts that are taken here in Arkansas usually end up going to some really large international fur auctions in Canada where buyers from all over the world, China, Europe, come to obtain the stock they need to build their clothing lines for the next year. So everything trapped in Arkansas is probably going to go to Canada, and then from there it could go anywhere in the world.
Trapping has existed in Arkansas for hundreds of years. Though not as prevalent as it once was, it's still an important part of the state's culture. And the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission is managing the fur bearer resource for the benefit of future generations.
Wildlife management has had a history of not being very good about regulating the take of certain species, resulting in some of them becoming endangered. But since professional wildlife management really started in the 1930s, we've been really focused on making sure that doesn't happen again. So we've really highly regulated activities like trapping, which could cause an impact to make sure that we keep the species we have, keep them common, and don't take more than the population can bear.
You know, we went to that fur sale, and Trey, you know, I think the one thing that shocked me the most about it was the number of furs there.
There were a lot of furs there. Well, man, one of the coolest things for me was thinking that one of these furs taken in Arkansas could end up on somebody's hat or jacket in Russia or France or wherever.
Could do it. Hey, folks, you stay tuned. We'll wrap the show up right after this last break. Hey, if you'd like a chance at winning a free hunting and fishing license here in Arkansas, watch this. Here's how it works.
Talkin' Outdoors presents the 2014 Watch and Win Giveaway. It's as easy as mailing a postcard or visiting the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission's Facebook page. Each week, we'll give away an Arkansas resident hunting and fishing license, a $35.50 value provided by Academy Sports and Outdoors. At the end of the year, we'll award the 2014 Grand Prize, a $1,000 lifetime hunting and fishing license provided by Electric Cooperatives of Arkansas, and a hummingbird banding expedition with the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. Here's how it works. Send a postcard to this address for a chance to win during each first run episode of Talkin' Outdoors, or become a fan of the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission's Facebook page and watch for details.
Let me remind you now to put all your contact information on those postcards that you mail in. This guy did it right. Trey, what's his name?
Out of Russellville, Arkansas, it's Bob Balkman.
Out of Russellville, congratulations, Bob. Hey, we'll see you next time right here on Talkin' Outdoors.